Matthew 8. What sort of man is this? So you remember the structure of Matthew moving back and forth between Jesus' words, teaching, and his works, miracles, and interacting with people. Matthew 5 to 7 just finished the Sermon on the Mount. And so Jesus' teaching in that block concludes with a summary statement that the crowds heard. They were amazed because he taught with authority, not like the scribes. The authority that's represented in Jesus' words, Matthew 5 to 7, now carries directly into Jesus' works, Matthew 8 and following, where we're going to see Jesus' power expressed in the miracles that he accomplishes. And that's summarized in several points within this chapter that we'll see as we continue to work through it. But for now, let's just get a summary understanding of how the chapter itself is structured. I want you to see a pattern of seven great works that Jesus accomplishes in this chapter, starting in verse 1, a leper that comes to him for healing. Verse 5, the centurion that comes appealing to him. Verse 14, Peter's mother-in-law, who's healed from a fever. Verse 16, many demons, and kind of a summary statement here, what I'm calling a mass healing. Verse 5, a crowd that comes to him, an interaction that Jesus has together with a scribe before that crowd. Verse 6, the great storm that Jesus calms. And verse 7, the two demon-possessed men that come asking, begging for healing. It's worth noticing in each one of these places a pattern. And the pattern is, yes, we have five miracles of discussion. We have Jesus interacting with people. The strong pattern throughout, though, is extraordinary faith. People that respond to Jesus in faith and Jesus' response to them in return. There is also a pattern of unexpected people coming, a leper, a Gentile centurion, a woman, and later, two people possessed by demons. These are unexpected people. People that have faith in places you would never anticipate, and Jesus' response to them. Let's talk about each one of these miracles in turn, one by one, starting with the healing of the leper. Multiple notable things here that are worthy of our comment. First, just notice the leper's faith. If you are willing, you can make me clean. There is no doubt from him that Jesus can do it. The question, will you cleanse me? Jesus' response to him is, I will be clean. Notice that immediately his leprosy is cleansed. That's a theme we'll return to in just a moment. But Jesus' response then to the man is very striking. See that you say nothing to anyone. Go, show yourself to the priest. Offer the gift that Moses commanded for a proof to them. Jesus is referencing here the Old Testament law. And Leviticus 13 and 14 gives a specific provision for how someone ought to deal with the problem of cleanliness if they have been healed from leprosy. But the interesting thing here is that Jesus has just a moment before not violated, but gone against expectations when it says he stretched out his hand and touched him. Of course, Jesus doesn't need to touch a person to heal him. In other places, Jesus heals just by the power of his words. But here, doing it this way is going to connect to Jesus' person as the basis or the reason that healing flows. And it's also very interesting that Jesus' cleansing flows in reverse. A leper should make Jesus unclean. That's the pattern. Haggai 2, 11 to 13 actually points this out. That if you touch an unclean thing, it makes you unclean. It never flows the other way, except in Jesus' case. And he touches the leper, but does not become unclean. And the result then is that the man is healed and the man is cleansed. And Jesus' command to him in reference to the law recognizes that Jesus is not unaware of all of this. In fact, Jesus is concerned to follow the law, a point that we'll return to a little later on. The second healing with the healing of the centurion, it's very striking here that this person is a Gentile. The argument of the centurion when he says, "You, I am not worthy to come under your roof, only say the word, I too am a man under authority," is that the centurion has recognized Jesus has the authority and backing of God. Jesus is not limited to some kind of magic words method or some kind of special trick. Jesus doesn't have to physically be there to touch. And that's striking, of course, just the juxtaposition. The previous miracle, he did cleanse by touch, but he doesn't have to. The centurion knows this. And the centurion also confesses by saying, "I too am a man under authority." He recognizes that Jesus has particular relationship with God. Jesus can act with the same authority as God himself, merely and strictly by using his words, his command. In verses 10 to 12, Jesus contrasts this faith with faith in Israel. "No one in Israel, with no one have I found such faith. Many will come from east and west, Gentiles," that's why I have a globe here, it's the emphasis of a worldwide faith, "while the sons of the kingdom," which can only mean Jewish people, "will be thrown into outer darkness." People who assume they are sons of the kingdom. People who, by their Jewishness, are sure that they'll be okay, will be cast out. Why? Because the essence of Jesus' response here is to faith. Not just to ethnicity. Being Jewish will not save a person. It's the faith. The next healing in verse 14 is in respect to Peter's mother-in-law. And the striking thing I would say about this particular story is that in this case, you should notice he touched her hand, the fever left her, and then notice how immediately she is able to get up and serve him. In other words, this is not like a convalescence kind of process. This is not the way that a doctor would work with somebody that then she would slowly recover. But it's immediate and total. And that ends this part of the chapter with a summary statement, just what I'm calling a mass healing. "That evening they brought to him many who were oppressed. He cast out the spirits with a word. He healed all who were sick." The sense of just a broad summary, there's so many healings, they can't all be recorded. Verses 18 to 22 describe responses of questionable faith. People who come to him with a kind of a response. A scribe saying, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus' response to him, "Well, okay, but I don't even have a home that I return to." Another disciple, quote unquote disciple, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Follow me, leave the dead to bury their own dead." This is not to say leave the father unburied, but the sense of it is the dying, taking care of the dying. But there is in this moment something so critical about Jesus' leadership and his ministry. This is not to say that someone should have no responsibilities to father and mother. I think the idea here, Jesus knowing something of what's in this person's heart, that this person's using this as an excuse. It's not just that the body has passed, the person has passed away, and so the man is saying, I just need to put him in the ground. It's a figure for, or language for saying, well, I need to take care of my father in these future years until he dies. And it's an excuse that this disciple is using. Jesus knows this, and he's responding to it. The calming of the storm in 23 and 27 is extremely striking. There's a great storm on the sea. The boat is being swamped by the waves. I think this is notable. Jesus was asleep. And part of the marvel of this particular detail is that the same one who has such power to do all of these miracles and even to stop the storm is sleeping. If he has the power to stop storms, if he has the power to overcome all sickness, why does he need to sleep? And that's a question that comes back in just a moment at the end of the story. But it already gets us a little bit of mental tension. What's going on in here? The storm rises up and it's getting worse, and the disciples are, of course, extremely afraid. It helps a little bit to understand what kind of boat they're talking about and have a little mental imagery for it. This is an actual boat that was excavated from the Sea of Galilee, and this was recovered. I mean, this is from the era and an actual understanding of what a boat like that would look like, or reconstructed and created in a model. What this probably would look like in the full form would be something like this. And you can see from it, it's enough that a group of people could fit in it just barely. There's not a lot of extra space here. It's a small boat. These are oars. There's space for four places where someone could be pushing with oars in the place, or six, four or six in the model six and the original four. And then a sail, a mast. Okay, so it's a sufficient worthy boat, but that being tossed by waves that pop up on the Sea of Galilee very quickly, then the disciples would be afraid, crying out, "Lord, save us, help us." There is, in some of the other accounts, even a sense of question, like, why are you so unconcerned that we're perishing? And Jesus' response to them is, it's as well striking. Why are you afraid? He asks. The response is not just that we'll be okay here, but actually a challenge to them that they should not be afraid at all. He rebukes the winds and the seas. This has kind of the picture of him petulant, of dealing with a petulant child. Stop it. And there's a great calm. And the men's response then here is critical. We'll come back to this question. They marveled, saying, "What sort of person is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" I think built into this question is not just the marvel of his greatness and his power, but even the question of, he was asleep a moment ago. He's a person. What sort of person is this? He's human and he needs sleep, but he stops the storm. What sort of person is this? And then the final miracle of the chapter is the two Gadarenes, the two demon-possessed men that come. And the question or the arrival here on this, the other side of the sea, brings them directly into conflict here with these extreme circumstances, these men who have demon possession to the extent, the full extent. The question in verse 27, what sort of man is this, is still in the disciples' minds when Jesus, encountering these demon-possessed men, hears the words coming back at him from the demons. And the demons are saying, what do you have to do with us, O Son of God? The demons know who he is. Striking that nothing in the story has Christ identifying himself to them. He never says who he is. He never gives a statement of his identity. They apparently just know. And you can see instances like this, Acts 19:15, the demons know a little of Jesus. James 2:19, the demons know that God is one and they tremble. The demons recognize Jesus' pre-existence, you have come. His right to judge, you have come to judge us and to deal with us. And even that they will eventually be damned. They know that their damnation is coming and it's inevitable. So, what are they then going to do in interaction with Jesus? The request that they give, send us away into the herd of pigs, is probably a strategic attempt to distract from Jesus, and it works. They go, they fill this herd that rushes down into the bank, and the herdsmen go, tell the story, and everyone comes out begging Jesus to depart from them. Jesus knows their strategy, he allows their strategy, and it kind of becomes something of a test of these people. What will their response be? The basic question goes, do these people value their pigs more than Jesus? And the answer is, well, in fact, they do. But the irony of it that's so beautiful is that the demon-possessed people in the end come. They are delivered. They place their faith in Jesus. And we discover that the demon-possessed men are going to be okay. It's the crowds that turn away. It's the crowds that reject. I'm going to end then with two Old Testament links that are very striking in Matthew chapter 8 and that are important for our consideration. The first is in verse 4. After Jesus heals the leper, He says, go, show yourself to the priest, offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony to them. And as I mentioned before, this references Leviticus 13 and 14, the provision or the method for healing a leper or when a leper has been healed. The thing that's so striking about that is you would not expect to use this command that often. And one imagines the leper arriving back and saying, so I've been healed, I'm a leper, and now my leprosy is gone, but I need to go through this process. And the priest going, oh, that's a rarely used one, filtering back through, unrolling scrolls, and trying to find what exactly were the provisions. How often would you use this? But if you notice Jesus' words, he's quite specific about the purpose for a testimony unto them. This is going to be a testimony to the priests to recognize the wonder of what Jesus has done. His intentions in the miracle are not just to get the problem solved of the leprosy, but he's working in lots of people's lives through what he does. And it again illustrates the pattern that we've mentioned several times. Jesus is not a lawbreaker. Jesus is the ultimate law keeper. He came not to set aside the law, he came to fulfill it. The other Old Testament link I want to highlight is a bit later in the chapter, but it's a critical, rich, and beautiful one. Here we find the language that they brought unto him many who were possessed with demons. He healed all who were sick. And all of this was that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah saying, he himself took our infirmities and bear our sickness. Now, where was that taken from? From Isaiah the prophet. It's 53 verse 4. He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. And that in the midst, of course, of Isaiah, a passage talking about Jesus' payment for our sins through the cross. What's going on here? I think the idea is one of the reasons that Jesus can heal disease and take it all away is to point to what he will do. He's eventually going to take away all sickness, every tear wiped away from every eye. And so at this point, the kind of comprehensive healing all their sick, taking away all their disease, is just a pointer to the future. Look at the greatness of what he will eventually do. This is a marvel. But not just that. Because part of the marvel of it is that it's already pointing to the cross. By quoting, citing this statement, Matthew says, and yes, Jesus is the one who will suffer and die for all of our sins. The cross is coming, and the cross will be central to the message of the book of Matthew. But the other part of the chapter that I want to conclude with, and that leaves us with the question that chapter 8 answers, this person, the power he has, the marvel of what he does, Matthew 8:27, what manner of person is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? What manner of person is this that has such power? What manner of person is this who would be asleep and yet can solve every problem? What manner of this of person is this who heals all of our diseases, but himself will die? And Matthew 8 is continuing to build that story and teach us the lesson of who Jesus is, the marvel of who this person is. But as we see each subsequent thing he does, we're supposed to marvel ourselves. What manner of person is this?